Teachers, fellow delegates, postgraduates, and my friends. I bring warm greetings from IIPS to all the members who are attending this conference. And I wish on behalf of IIPS this Karnataka Chapter Conference a great success. First of all, I thank Kanishka for inviting me for this meet and giving me this honor to talk in front of you. I am supposed to talk on neonatal surgery, setting up a unit in a rural area. In 1988, I passed MCH from Grant Medical. I worked after that 2 years in Bombay, and straightway I rushed to my native place, Sangli, which is a district headquarters. Before I joined Sangli in a pediatric surgery practice, there were 3-4 pediatric surgeons in our area. Dr. Ravindra Hora, who is a senior, almost 15 years senior to me, who did his FRCS and worked with in GOS, had started pediatric surgery in Sangli city. But he was doing general surgery too. Dr. Kittur at Kolhapur, Dr. Anil Halgari at Hubli, and Dr. Vijay Patil at Solapur. These were 4 pediatric surgeons in our area. So I entered in such an environment at Sangli. I had a government job also, and I started the practice also. This lecture is prepared with the intention for postgraduates to attract at the periphery. Because after working in big institutes, it appears that neonatal surgery with so many gadgets and so many monitors, so many ventilators, is it practically possible at a rural area or a district headquarter without all this setup? The answer to this is yes. Is Mr. William Lyatt, who is a founder of neonatal surgery in the history, and is known with Lyatt's bands in malrotation. Sir Dennis Brown started neonatal surgery in Great Ormond State Hospital, and his principle was the aim of pediatric surgery is to set a standard and not to seek a monopoly. Probably establishing big centers in the metro cities, there is a monopoly of bigger cities in the treatment of pediatric surgery and neonatal surgery. This policy has to be decentralized. And that's what was the aim of Sir Dennis Brown. Peter Rickham, who was a student of Sir Dennis Brown and did his thesis on metabolic response of newborn to surgery, the credit of establishing world's first neonatal surgical unit goes to Peter Rickham. When we plan to establish a neonatal surgical unit at periphery, at a district level, we have to consider 4 factors. 1, patient, because there is a technology of neonatal surgery, there is a technician, pediatric surgeon, both in search of a patient at a district level. 2 is infrastructure, 3 is the staff, and 4, anesthetists and other practitioners, which I am going to talk subsequently. See, in search of a patient, I am saying this specifically because neonatal surgical problems are not oriented to many of our practitioner colleagues, including pediatricians. I will say this with examples. Forget about general public, because they will be shocked that one day baby is to be operated when you talk with them. I am not talking about the scenario in metros or bigger cities. This is about the rural area or a district level. Now, most important in search of a patient, the work we have to do as a doctor or as a pediatric surgeon or neonatal surgeon is to create awareness about these malformations in general public and medical professionals, that these are the possible malformations and these require urgent surgical intervention and how to come to the diagnosis. This we can do by various ways of giving lectures in Rotary Club, Giants Club, Lions Club, or any wherever you get a chance, you have to project. Regarding medical professionals, you have to give talks in IMAs, IIT meetings, Surgical Society, and so on. The whole idea is that we cannot just go and sit in one hospital and wait for patient to come. You have to struggle for making the awareness in the society. Nowadays, lot of antenatal diagnosis is done and anomalies are diagnosed and they need counseling. Imagine a district where there is no pediatric surgeon. Whatever the clinician or obstetrician decides will be decided. There has to be a pediatric surgeon to counsel, to reassure the relatives that this hydronephrosis after birth has no problem, no risk to the baby, with confidence, with examples. Otherwise, no obstetrician is honored to deliver a child with birth defect. Many times the relatives, they don't want termination, but there has to be someone solid behind the patient's emotions, and that work has to be done by a neonatologist. Unless there is a pediatric surgeon who talks about early diagnosis of these anomalies, I will cite some examples. For example, newborn with bilious vomiting. The pediatrician feels that there is no distension, child is passing stool, it cannot be obstruction. But we have to impress that bilious vomiting is the diagnostic of intestinal obstruction in neonates, whether there is distension or not. This is malrotation. Many times these babies are admitted in NICU with conservative management, and by the time they reach to you, there is gangrene of the bowel. So, in short, the clinical picture of these anomalies has to be impressed on the pediatricians, general practitioners, and so on. Then early diagnosis can be done. Same thing happens with esophageal atresia. The grandmother is telling the doctor, obstetrician, that the baby is having trough, but the obstetrician doesn't have time to look into that. By the time the baby reaches to pediatric surgeon, already there is a aspiration pneumonia. It is late and the prognosis will be difficult. What about the transport of a neonate in a rural area? You can see this picture of a bullock cart and the bad condition of roads. This is the situation at periphery. However, there are no helicopters or big ambulances and so on in the rural area. In the available resources, the baby has to reach you early, and this will be done by much of awareness. Once the baby reaches to you, the relatives are under tremendous pressure. Firstborn child with so much anomaly, whether the surgery will be sustained by the baby, what will be the outcome? We have to counsel the parents. We have to give reassurance to them and prepare for surgery. Next question comes, okay doctor, you are telling us, what about the expenses? It is a big question. We cannot compare the outcome of financial gain in neonatal surgery in metro cities and peripheries. You have to go ahead for surgery considering the charity. Wherever it is needed, we have to give charity. And we have to operate. Then what a pediatric surgeon is gaining by doing such a stressful job? It is satisfaction. One. Two. If you prove neonatal surgical cases successful at periphery, that will establish you as a pediatric surgeon at district level. It is not everything for money, but professional satisfaction and establishing as a pediatric surgeon. This is a Sangli is located, which is around 450 kilometers from Mumbai, Pune. Adjacent centers are Belgavi and Bijapur. Now we come to the infrastructure of NICU at district level. a new pediatric surgeon entering at a place at a district level should not, I don't expect that he should have a standard NICU for doing neonatal surgery. It is practically impossible for him because he has to invest in building equipment, scopes, laparoscope, cystoscope, and so on. So how NICU setup in the early stages will be standard? What is needed is one room, cradles, warmers, oxygenation, suction. You start with that. This is the NICU setup which we have got. This is just for, I'm not going to the details. Regarding the ventilator, after working in metro cities, I think nobody will dare to start NICU surgery at district level without ventilator. But that is not so. In the first 15 years of my practice, I didn't have ventilator. But as need arises, I had shifted these neonates to institutes for ventilation. Everything is not possible in one stroke. As you build up your practice, you go ahead for further things. But I believe a portable X-ray is must. Many times we cannot ship the babies with distress and critical stage to X-ray department outside. And I suggest the young pediatric surgeons to attend all X-rays, all ultrasounds. They should go personally. What you are expecting in this neonate? It is not that just write the form and send it to X-ray and whatever the picture. You go there, you see the X-ray. If needed, you repeat the X-ray. If needed, you do contrast study. In one stroke, the study has to be completed. Now, this is a cradle care, what I can say, for a low dependency NICU. This is a locally made wooden cradle, and this is overhead warmer. This will not cost you much in the early days of practice. These are the lamps which I had used in early days of practice for overhead warming. And the same NICU can be used as a feeding for the babies, and mothers have got a free access to the NICU. This is real intensive care unit with all the gadgets, ventilator, suction and so on. What I mean to say that infrastructure, that for a beginner, what is needed is a proper warmer, isolation, oxygenation, suction. All sophisticated gadgets we can go on gradually. I will come to the monitors and other things later on. The next point to be discussed is a staff. In all the institutes, there will be trained staff, pediatric nurses, ICU nurses, OT nurses. But that is not so for a newcomer who is beginning his practice at district level. There is a question of availability of trained nurses. You might get a retired one, old one, or one who doesn't have a job. But we have to start with available resources there. A pediatric surgeon is a key person. He has to perform multiple roles. As a surgeon, as an anesthetist, as a technician, as a nurse, you have to educate everyone. And we have to teach them the basic NICU care. I'm not going to the details, but how to warm, how to do the suction, oxygenation. We have taught the compounders or nurses how to do intubation. And recently, we had a neonatal resuscitation course for the hospital workers, which was organized by IIT Sangli City. Staff training is most important. In simple words, you have to teach them what is this anomaly and what care is required. For example, in Keogh fistula, in the post-operative period, when you do suction, we have to instruct the staff that why the suction catheter should not be pushed too much inside, which can damage anastomosis. For a nursing purpose, we have designed NICU and post-operative recovery in a one campus with isolation. So with the minimum number of staff, we can manage the good number of critical babies. The other specialties, one which we should not forget, are radiology and pathology. Because most of the radiologists which are working at periphery, they may not be adequately exposed for pediatric surgical procedures. So you have to take the baby, go to the radiology department, discuss with the radiologist, what do you expect, whether it is an X-ray, contrast, or a sonography, and so on. Same thing is true for pathologists, especially for histopathology of Hirschsprung disease. It was a training for us to see the slides of Hirschsprung's and get cross-checked with the pathologist. And then we have to train the pathologist there for Hirschsprung's histology. In fact, four pathologists from Sangli City I had deputed to St. John's when they had organized histopathology of Hirschsprung disease. And they eagerly, all of them came and they took a training here. The next point to be considered is anesthesiologist. The anesthesiologist who is working at district level, most of them, they have never exposure to pediatric surgery. So if I go and tell them, this is the way I want, the official, I want tracheum and so on control, he will be scared or he might refuse your call. So whatever limited resources, instead of standard things advising to anesthesiologists, you ask in what you are competent. I want TO fistula to be done for this newborn. You talk with the anesthesiologist in which method he is competent. And I tell you, most of the, I am talking about 25 years back, most of the anesthesiologists those days were masters in ether. I will say ether is the safest anesthetic drugs. There will be a lot of controversy on this topic, I know. Even in our Deccan meeting, we used to have fight on this issue. But what the message is that instead of advocating standard or all recent things, you whatever that anesthetist is competent in managing, let him manage. Don't impose your, and slowly we can change him. Many times they are not able to put the tubes, we have to put the tubes. This is a open drop technique of ethyl chloride and this mass. These, for example, this big cystic hygromas with difficult intubations. If you paralyze the patient and tube is not passed, we have to do tracheostomy. But with this open drop techniques, we had managed so many difficult intubation patients. I am talking older patients, not all newborns. Earlier days, the Boyle's was rare, in Boyle's apparatus was not available. I am talking 25 years back at all the hospitals. And people used to put ether into this bottle. And this is called as a Dabba Batli classically. And this was an endotracheal tube. So the baby will take the ether as much as needed. Once baby sleeps, baby will stop taking the ether. Now this is the recent photograph of my boy's machine. I have changed with the time. There is halothane, cyofluorine, but this ether bottle is persistent. Bath water needs to be changed, but don't throw the baby out. I give free hand to my anesthetist. You decide what needs to be used. And even there are some senior anesthetists, they are using ether today and we had no problem. Regarding the monitors, the gold standard, I think everybody knows that esophageal stethoscope is a wonderful, which works, goes to the posterior mediastinum here. And whatever measure patient is weight, moving the position, the monitoring will be excellent. Pulse ox, otherwise recent pulse ox, if the baby is cold, you cannot see anything. These are ECG monitors, these are recent multi-para monitors, which we have got now, but we started with esophageal stethoscope. Now during the surgery, prepare the OP in advance, transport the neonate with the bell-wrapped Gamzee pads, minimize the duration of anesthesia, and patient warming pads. Now recently hot pads are there, but earlier we had used hot water bottle or even hair dryer, which can produce lot of heat in the post-operative warming of the child. Umbilical catheterization, whenever we used to do laparotomy, we used to put a catheter in the umbilical vein, and that used to sort out the subsequent IV fluids. Now this is last 3 years experience of our surgical work in newborns at Sangli, and the commonest as usual was anorectal malformation, and next to it was neonatal obstruction and TO fistula. In summary, neonatal surgery is safe at district level in the available resources. There is a need of lot of awareness to be created in medical profession and non-medical profession by various ways, by medias, newspapers, magazines and so on. And it is a constant process. You cannot give one lecture and sleep for next 5 years. Neonatal surgeon has multiple roles as a surgeon, as an administrator, as a health to anesthetist, training of a staff, and so on. I agree that the resources are limited, but in the limited resources, we can do better work. And don't forget charity. Without charity, we cannot do neonatal surgery at periphery. This charity will be compensated in other work. You will get money. I am not saying that you will not get money. You will get money to fullest satisfaction. But neonatal surgery you do for pleasure. And as I say, it will establish you as a pediatric surgeon. Because there is if one neonate is operated and goes to some village, entire village discusses, one day baby is operated and this great person. So that will establish you as a pediatric surgeon at district level. So we have to continue this neonatal surgery if needed in charity. So at the end, I strongly appeal the young pediatric surgeons who have not decided to establish where they should prefer a district place.